astrophysics, my old friend. I've come to learn from you again. What you have proven with experiments, what you have seen with your fine instruments.
If you get enough atoms together, even just starting with the simple ones, like hydrogen and helium, and give them enough time and enough energy and a little room to play around in, they will get into some serious trouble. The story of how enormous clouds of atoms ignite into hot stars, and how clumps of dust form around those baby stars and grow and grow and grow until they become baby planets made of hot lava, and eventually spawn living, breathing, beer-drinking organisms, some of whom make it all the way to the United States Supreme Court, is a story that could take your breath away. Give them enough time to mingle and mix and churn, and eventually they will create you and me. You are composed of 38 trillion cells, 84 minerals, 23 elements, 8 gallons of water, a handful of olives, and 2 Budweisers. So I'm glad you're here tonight, folks. I'm even more glad I'm here because, well, according to even the most inconceivable odds, according to the most unlikely course of events and incomprehensibly improbable twists of fate, none of us were supposed to be here. Even the parking lot was hard to figure out. In one possible alternate reality, we're still small mammals living mostly underground, hiding from big reptiles. Or we're still hanging out in the trees deep in the Uganda rainforest, grooming each other and picking tropical spiders off each other. None of this modern human experience was necessarily supposed to happen, except under the most unlikely sequence of random events. The epic story of humankind, from the rise of mammals, turning slowly into primates, slowly standing upright, slowly turning into modern humans, then quickly turning right back into primates, is happening right before our very eyes. There had to be enough break between ice ages. There had to be a long enough gap between asteroid hits. The Rift Valley in Africa had to start pulling the plates apart right when it did, and right where it did, to get our canopy-loving, furry ancestors to literally jump out of the trees and start foraging for food in the open savannas. And here we are today, leaning back in comfy chairs that tilt at 22 degrees, perhaps with a little Taco Bell in our stomach, moments away from doing something Albert Einstein could only dream of doing. Fly at the speed of light through the stars and through the galaxies. Welcome to Even the Earth is Bipolar. My name is Gregg Eisenberg, and I will be your concierge for the next hour. Amanda will be running the universe for us. And in that time, I want you to know the Earth will move close to 1,000,000 miles through space from its current position. Carried along by the Milky Way galaxy, carried along by our own orbits, 1,000,000 miles will be traversed in the next hour. But you won't feel a thing. Do you know why? Because we're that good. Just a couple quick notes about myself for those of you who don't know me. I got my BA in psychology in California, then I got my MA in Boston in mental illness. Then I moved back to the West Coast and I got my MDMA up in Berkeley. I live in Boulder now. This is my home dome. Welcome to my living room. When I'm not doing stand-up philosophy, I work as a geographer. I focus on energy and climate change. I'm one of the founding members of Cartographers Without Borders. We want to help the world, but the phone hasn't been ringing much lately. I'm also a musician. I play the conundrums. Not that well. I only do comedy part-time, sometimes to help make ends meet. I do tragedy on the side. We have a lot to talk about tonight. Sea level rise, the rise of mammals, how stars are born, and I don't mean Justin Bieber. We need to talk about us a little bit. We need to talk about where we come from, where we are going. We are the apex predator on the great planet Earth. We're apes gone apex. And we need to talk because the life systems that support us are a little brittle. Because the clock is running on Homo sapiens. The sands of time are swiftly passing through our fingers. We're at that point that every intelligent species on every planet, in every solar system, in every galaxy eventually faces once they develop the scientific method, once they figure out how to harness energy, and once they finally learn how to ship Ben and Jerry's ice cream cross country. They realize, just in the nick of time, as is the case with us, that Cherry Garcia ice cream cannot and will not just keep on going forever without new energy inputs, without access to new sources of sunlight, without finding new deposits of macadamia nuts. That's why it's imperative that we review the facts in a new way. That's why we need to consider the facts from some new angles. It takes a lot more than just liquid water at the surface to make complex life forms. Okay, it usually requires a rocky terrestrial planet that has the right surface pressure and right temperatures. It requires the right chemicals, the right atmosphere, and usually at least a few good shots of Irish whiskey. E.O. Wilson, the Harvard evolutionary biologist who wrote The Social Conquest of Nature, said himself there are three things you need to get to modern industrialized life. You need a terrestrial planet with land. You need to get out of the water and up onto dry land. You need to free your hands and develop opposable thumbs so that you can invent washing machines and toaster ovens and post things onto Instagram. And you need jazz. There's no way any of this is going to sustain very long without great jazz.
Astrophysics, my old friend, I've come to learn from you again what you have proven with experiments, what you have seen with your fine instruments. In the sky and the sea and the soil, in the ground, it's so profound. I love the sound of science. What is this thing that we call light? What is the speed of its swift flight? Is it a thing that has mass at all? Is it a wave or a particle? Does space have a way the laws of geometry, like you and me, on the stage of science? Who said I do not know? Radiation makes you glow. Keep it up in the ground. A better place for it cannot be found. In the words of Einstein, I'm written in the chemistry halls. The future calls. This is the age of science. If we could harvest wind and sea to quench our thirst for energy, we could live here for eternity and fulfill this planet's destiny. And the wolf will return to the plains of the northern tree and run so free, hearing the song.
me out, folks.
Earth is Bipolar, my old friend. I've come to learn from you again. What you have proven with experiments.
Can't hear you,
what
folks.
What you have seen with your fine instruments. The sky and the sea and the soil in the ground. It's so profound. I love the sound of science.
All planets have difficult childhoods. Ours certainly did. It's still in therapy. All solar systems have difficult beginnings. Ours did. The kids fight. There's nothing you can do about it. Think about it. Clouds of stellar dust spin with so much energy and so much centrifugal force, they flatten out into the shape of a disk. This is the pizza dough theory of star systems. If you ever worked in a pizza parlor, you know exactly what I mean. You don't have to be Italian to understand this. You throw up the dough and spin it, and centrifugal forces stretch it into a pancake and push a lot of the heavy mass to the outer part of the disk. And when young star systems are forming, the way the mass gets distributed depends on, one, how thick the dough is, two, how fast it's tossed, and three, perhaps most importantly, whether we're talking New York or Chicago-style pizza. But it's a free-for-all. It's a mayhem for the first million years. Planets shift orbits and bump into each other and fight for position. It's like a family of newborn piglets all vying for position around their mama's belly. The early solar system was full of cataclysmic crashes and mind-boggling collisions. We know this because Neptune actually still spins almost completely on its side. We know this because Venus is whirling backwards through space. The Earth's moon, our big, beautiful moon, was formed by a massive near head-on collision between young baby Earth and another baby planet named Theia. When the Earth was young, it was so beat up and hit from so many directions by so many objects, it didn't know which way was up. It disassociated for a while. It's still wobbling on its axis like a Hanukkah dreidel. It took millions of years for our solar system to achieve the group stability it now has. Now, the James Webb Telescope is showing us for the first time that big, gassy, giant planets that are usually thrown to the outer rims during the pizza dough phase use their size and leverage to move on in on the smaller planets and push them around, bully their way into the closest orbits during what I call the piglet phase. And the big gassy planets will be merciless about this. They will encroach and displace smaller rocky planets without batting an eye. They'll screw up their orbits so much that sometimes the little guys get ejected out of the solar system altogether and become rogue planets, forever drifting in interstellar space. A lot of them end up in places like Boulder, Colorado, and do trauma-informed psychotherapy. I know some of those guys. In the vast majority of star systems that the James Webb has looked at, just in the past 3 months, big gassy planets that can't even support life move into the star's Goldilocks zones, where temperatures are mild. And that's the irony. You have great stars with great light and great potential, but no life. No life anywhere as far as the eye can see. But when the smoke cleared in our solar system, however, a few million years later, things were not as bad for planet Earth as we had once feared. The Earth actually won the cosmic lottery in so many ways. Perfect distance from the right kind of star. Maybe not best in class, but a very good star. We have a nice spin too, not rotating too fast, which would make us all manic, and not rotating too painfully slow, which would ruin our tans. There's an almost perfect amount of water, not too much, not too little. There's a decent amount of tequila and enough Irish whiskey to get us through the next 4 years. It's even got the perfect number of Walmarts. 4,720. 90% of the U.S. lives within 10 miles of a Walmart. It's a real paradise. There's so many things that could have gone wrong. Jupiter could have started creeping in towards the center of the solar system. Our very big stabilizing moon could have turned out to be tiny, meaning we'd be wobbling way too much. Or even worse, Herschel Walker could have won in Georgia. When you think of all the hurdles that had to be overcome for you to be here tonight, leaning back at 22 degrees, it is truly mind-boggling. Now, when we look out into the galaxy, we often ask, is there advanced life out there? Are they more advanced than us? Are we alone in the Milky Way? Are we possibly the most advanced civilization in the entire universe? Well, if you watched any of the January 6th commission earlier this year, you know we're not. But maybe that's not even the right question to be asking anyway. Maybe the Earth wouldn't win most advanced civilization. But maybe there's other categories we would win. Like, I don't know, maybe we'd win best orchids this side of Ursa Minor. Or maybe we'd win best plate tectonics this side of the Milky Way. Or maybe even most beautiful beaches in the Virgo supercluster. And we'd be like, whoa, we didn't see that coming. Or maybe, envelope please, most beautiful woman in the galaxy goes to planet Earth. Yeah, or maybe we'd win a lesser category, like most variation of sponges. Or cockroaches. Or mollusks, who knows? Maybe we'd win best Indian food this side of Orion's belt. Like, we could be the only planet in the universe with coconuts and fenugreek. We're certainly not gonna win best drivers. We're certainly not gonna win most likely to succeed. Hate to tell you that. And we won't win best star. Our sun is nice, but it will probably only live 10 billion years. And I hate to tell you this, and it's hardest on the family, but it's probably only got a good 5 billion years left, at best. Some stars will last for 30 billion years, and that's without the Viagra. Imagine what life forms they could support. Imagine how many Walmarts those planets will have. And that's just the way it is. You can choose your friends, but you can't choose your star. Our sun will run out of energy and become a white dwarf. And as anticlimactic as that may sound, thank God we aren't parked near a red giant. Red giants may be huge and they may burn bright, and they may seem to be all that. But they don't last that long. They only live a few hundred million years. You can't get much life in that little time. Planets around red giants may develop a nice variety of sponges, but they'll never get to experience the bean burritos at Taco Bell. It just takes too long for evolution to occur. Life takes a long time to come about. Starting with the Big Bang, the big explosive beginning of all time and space, only three elements were formed: hydrogen, helium, and lithium. The hydrogen was for making water. The helium was for my kid's birthday party. And the lithium is for my ex-wife. Everything heavier than hydrogen, helium, and lithium, all the way up to lead, came a billion years later out of the fusion in stars. And all the elements heavier than lead, which include some of the best stuff out there, gold, copper, cobalt, Adderall, all of them form when very, very large stars explode at the end of their lives in supernova. Only 1% of stars will ever go supernova. Only 1 or 2 per century happen in the Milky Way on average. But there hasn't been one in our galaxy for 500 years. So astronomers have to study the ones happening in other galaxies. You can't just sit around and wait. It's publish or perish. Yet these are all vital elements for our lives. If it weren't for gold, the New World may never have been discovered. Colorado may never have been on the map. Boulder was originally a small supply town for the big gold mining towns up in the hills. If it weren't for the Colorado Gold Rush and the CU football team, we probably wouldn't be here tonight. Seismic activity is another life-supporting process. And not all planets have it. Volcanic eruptions, lava flows, even hurricanes keep churning up new nutrients, keep recycling and replenishing the chemical composition of the atmosphere, and keep creating new land masses. Mount Shasta in California has had 4 major eruptive periods just during the past 15,000 years. Statistically, that's more frequent than the Cubs win the World Series. You see, the Earth isn't flat, like some people say, but the Earth is flatulent. Yeah, the Earth is sometimes very flatulent. I'm one of the founders of the Flatulent Earth Society. Now, well, a little flatulence is necessary for life. Too much is a problem. Periods of unremitting flatulence, volcanic eruptions gone crazy, sometimes for thousands of years, are responsible for 4 out of the 9 mass extinction events that have occurred on planet Earth. But that's the price we pay for having a nice liquid core. Having a nice large core made of molten lead is what gives us our protective magnetosphere. Let's take a look at how that works. Because of how quickly we spin, and because our core is liquid, the Earth creates a nice protective magnetic field around itself. The magnetic shield protects the Earth's atmosphere from the intense solar radiation that we don't want. If we didn't have the shield around us, not only would we have to wear much more sunscreen, solar winds would blow our entire atmosphere away. So when you consider that huge eruption that hit Tonga this summer, that shook the entire Pacific plate and was felt all the way in Alaska, or if you lived on the Big Island near Pahoa, which was sunk under lava flows 4 years ago, you might be tempted to ask, why do we have to have these deadly volcanic eruptions? Or if you lived in the Santa Cruz Mountains near San Francisco during the 1989 World Series and felt the earth shake violently beneath your feet like I did, you might think, why do these dang tectonic plates have to shift and move around so much? But that's the price we pay for having a really nice magnetic force field protecting all of us, not just some of us. Look, Mars, our next door neighbor, used to have a liquid core. That's Mars. It used to have a magnetic shield around it protecting its atmosphere. It used to have water and land masses, but then, about 2 billion years ago, its liquid core hardened due to no fault of its own. Somehow the inspectors missed it. And then, bam, before you can say, please refill my wife's lithium prescription, its entire atmosphere was completely blown away by solar winds. We don't want to be like that. What does Mars look like today? I think we all know. It's not as colorful as that. Amanda, show us what Mars looks like today.
Yes, here it is.
So, you know, if having 4,700 Walmarts on the surface of your planet is the goal, you got to have a molten core. You got to be the right distance from the right kind of star. You got to have a big moon stabilizing your wobble. You got to spin at the right speed. You got to be located downwind from ancient supernova. You got to have the right amount of water. You need booze. You need jazz and tiki torches on beautiful beaches. Because, you know, folks, when you step back and stop to think about it, between variations in climate, asteroid collisions, volcanic activity, it would almost seem like the creator of all of this likes to hit the reset button on life from time to time. Now, you can cry about that all you want, but it really worked to our advantage. For much of the 150 million years that dinosaurs ruled the world, mammals were a pretty wimpy, unknown class of animals. Mammals, known for their fabulous mammary glands, scurried around at night, scared of predators most of the time. But finally, after 150 million long Earth years of being total nobodies, after 150 million long years of playing second fiddle to a bunch of cold-blooded, pea-brained reptiles, one auspicious day, 66 million years ago, and their loss was our gain, the big asteroid came, 6 miles wide, 6 miles deep, and it landed in Mexico, near Yucatan, just on the other side of the wall. Like a ball of fire, this one rogue piece of space rock took down the enormous class of animals that had ruled the planet for, well, far longer than we ever will. And the dinosaurs lasted that long without recycling their aluminum cans. They did it without reusing their plastic bags or driving a Prius. But poof, the asteroid vaporized in an instant. A shockwave spread around the entire world, and before long, the dinosaurs were wiped out, along with 75% of the species of their time. Wiped out forever. We underground critters are among the few that survived. Now, a lot of us say we love biodiversity, but you don't hear too many people cry about that extinction event. Now, do you? We needed the dinosaurs gone so we could take back the night. Pearl Street Mall just wasn't big enough for the both of us. And now we are definitely here. There's 8 billion of us now. Now, before I tire you all out, I want to get to some of the hard facts. We live in one of the Earth's coolest chapters ever. We warm-blooded animals, and some of us like me are hot-blooded, like temperatures on the cool side. We are creatures of the ice age, and we like our polar regions nice and icy. Spicy and icy, that's how I like it. We're a little bit like David Lee Roth from Van Halen, who once said, "I used to jog, but the ice kept falling out of my glass." For most of the Earth's history, it existed in much hotter conditions. If we could look at that other slide real quick, and then I do want to come back to this one. Actually, one more. Let's keep going. Yeah, this one. For a long time, as you can see, back in the day, it was hot. Palm trees grew at the poles. Tropical forest spread all the way up to Manitoba. Manitoba, that's the place on the other side of the wall that Canada built to keep us out. But why did it get so cold in the first place about 30 million years ago? What happened back then? There are a few different theories. Some geologists say it was the Indian subcontinent slamming into the Asian continent and forming the mighty Himalaya Mountains. Because that enormous mountain range literally changed the land to air ratio on the planet and brought us into the Ice Age. Others say it was Jack Nicholson in The Shining. Just gave us all chills. But primates evolved into Homo erectus and then Homo sapiens during this decidedly cooler period. Right, all in the last 400, 600,000 years. Within this overall cooler chapter, There are these Milankovitch cycles playing out every 20,000 years or so. Big ups followed by severe downs. I don't know how to tell you this, but your planet is in the middle of a 200,000-year-long manic depressive episode. And this is the context of our species' rise to power. Our species left Africa and came to populate and dominate the four corners of the Earth in just the last few cycles. All of known recorded history has occurred within the last 2,000 years, within this most dramatic and recent upslope. The Earth has been warming for about 10,000 years after a nice long run of chilly temperature. Now, if things were to continue in this cyclic and somewhat dysthymic way they've been going for the last 100,000 years, we arguably should be hitting a peak soon, maybe in the next 500 or 1,000 years, and then start yet another cooling period. Hey, that could still happen. Maybe we can't break these up and down cycles, no matter how much lithium we take. And let's say that is what happens. It won't be long before we're complaining about how damn cold it is, about how short the growing seasons are, about how no one goes around in skirts anymore. We'd call it global cooling. The global blue house effect would be on. Environmentalists would be out on Pearl Street screaming, "Drill, baby, drill." Al Gore's great-great-great-great-grandnephew would be saying, "We can't let this beautiful biosphere freeze, not under our watch. We got to reverse this runaway blue house effect." The Earth firsters will be out driving big Hummers, throwing wild CO2 parties. But if you look at this Colorado chart, there are enough reasons to worry that, at least in the near term, temperatures won't peak and then cool anytime soon. They may just keep going up. We may be blowing the circuits on this popsicle stand. Humans may actually break the Milankovitch cycle, which has ruled the Earth for so long, to begin an age we might call the Pyrocene. Runaway greenhouse effect, almost as serious as runaway bride. The Venus syndrome. Hey, we're no stranger to fires here in Boulder County. The great race against time is happening. Will we learn to manage ourselves and our world just in the nick of time before a runaway greenhouse effect takes hold? Suspense is killing me. But there might be little we can do to stop it at this point. There's not about to be another continent smashing into another continent anytime soon. Jack Nicholson can't stop it. Even Tom Hanks can't stop it. Americans aren't about to give up their summer road trips. French aren't about to stop eating their croissants filled with ham and tater tots. There's certain processes in nature, once they start, they can't really be stopped. The best example is Netflix. Once you start watching Breaking Bad, there's really nothing you can do to stop it. Another one is the runaway greenhouse effect. Once the conditions are right, a little bit of methane, a little bit of CO2, maybe a couple billion cars, and warming can't be stopped. So let's say for a minute that is what happens. Let's say the Earth is freshly catapulted right out of the Ice Age and into the Pyrocene. There's three possible outcomes that could result. Totalitarian fascist governments could take over our world. Totalitarian socialist government could take over our world. Or three, everything just naturally works itself out. We're going to need to learn how to control our global temperature if we are going to survive even 1% as long as the damn dumb dinosaurs. Hey, but look, there's always going to be winners and losers. Hotter temperatures are going to be great for ferns. You're not going to hear any ferns crying. And palm trees and banana trees, it's going to be great for cockroaches. Did you know there are 4,500 different kinds of cockroaches just in New York City alone? The creator also seems to have a real cockroach fetish, too. Hey, maybe we'd win most variations of cockroaches. At least we'd be on the scoreboard. For an advanced industrialized civilization to last for thousands and maybe even millions of years, on any planet, there will always be some growing pains. As societies become more industrialized, they're absolutely going to have to learn how to do three things. Learn how not to destroy their nest with pollution and heat. Learn how to defend themselves against incoming asteroids. And get through the era of rap music without destroying each other. We're still squarely facing each of these threats. The human brain, anthropologists say, doubled in size about 200,000 years ago when we learned how to catch big game and cook meat. I think we're going to go through a big growth spurt right now, and it can't happen fast enough. Now, Einstein, who was against war, published his paper on general relativity on November 25th, 1915. And he did it without computers, without Excel spreadsheets. All he had was the dang calculator and his old flip phone. Well, let's ride on a beam of light, shall we, everybody? That's what Einstein was dreaming of. So let's do it. Let's buckle up, folks, and remember, 186,000 miles per second. It's not just a good idea. It's the law. The Chinese say a good fence makes good neighbors. I think we ought to agree in the age of space travel that many light years of distance also makes pretty good neighbors. By the way, we're at cruising speed now, about a million times the speed of light. Feel free to get up and walk around the cabin. Now, what do I mean by good neighbors? You know, after studying the issue of advanced life on other planets, I think there are three conclusions we need to make. One, there is life out there, and plenty of it. Maybe only microorganisms most of the time, on planets all over the Milky Way and throughout the billions of other galaxies. Two, we're never going to encounter each other directly. The distances are just too great. And three, Aerosmith is still the greatest rock band of all time. You think it's the Stones, but I say, dream on. Because when we listen for signs of other intelligent life, the galaxy is silent. That's because it's big. Really big. It's so big, it takes light 100,000 years to cross the Milky Way. It's so big, if we send information out to the universe at the speed of light, which we do with radio waves all the time, even just 10% across the galaxy, it would take 10,000 years to reach its destination, and then another 10,000 years to get an answer back. That's assuming they even text. And people are of mixed opinion whether we should bring attention to ourselves in the Milky Way. I am of the opinion we should not be broadcasting our existence to the galaxy too much. If they know we're here, they're just going to come down and steal all our Jerry Garcia bootleg tapes. Then where will we be? I say, not on my watch. I agree with Stephen Hawking. We should shut the heck up. But we've been sending out radio signals into the universe for over 100 years now, moving at the speed of light. That means that there's a sphere of about 100 light years around us in every direction that we have already touched with our radio signals. The signal might be weak, but it's out there, if anyone knows how to listen for it. It's called the radio sphere. It includes about 15,000 stars. And the planets located about 100 light years out could be tuning into some Al Jolson right about now. The ones about 65 light years out could be listening to Johnny Cash right about now. Oh, 1972 was exactly 50 years ago. That means the planetary system 50 light years away could be listening to the Bee Gees right about now. And they're probably asking themselves, in real time, are they just tuning their guitars, or is that really how the song goes? The planets about 10 light years out are just now finding out Obama was reelected. But we're not only broadcasting our news and music, we're broadcasting our location. So far, to over 15,000 star systems in our little suburban neighborhood of the Milky Way. Now, before you get alarmed, let me put that in perspective. That is 1/350,000th of the stars in the Milky Way. So if we think of the entire Milky Way galaxy as the state of Colorado, which is about 300 miles across, with Boulder as the black hole in the center, and Fiske Planetarium as ground zero, our radio signal has barely left campus. And I'm fine with that. But once our radio signal crosses Broadway and starts creeping up towards Ward and Gold Hill, we should be a little scared. They're just going to listen to some of those recordings and try to do some of their own Johnny Cash impersonations. But we're spying on them too. We're looking for them. The James Webb Telescope is mankind's greatest next step to understanding the universe. It's better, I'm told, than mushrooms. Looks across space into the past, into the deep past, and it's telling us things about the past we didn't know for sure until now. For example, we now know Tom Brady really did deflate the football at Super Bowl 46. We kind of knew that already. Going a few years further back, and this really surprised scientists, it turns out Obama really was born in Kenya. A lot of us have been saying that for a long time. But one of the biggest surprises of all, it turns out, the mighty pyramids in Giza, built over 2,500 years ago, were originally financed by Goldman Sachs. I think we as a species are in a philosophical transitional phase. The scientific facts of life, from the workings of DNA to the workings of entire galaxies, are only now coming into light. Like only in the past 10 years did we find out for sure that Brazilian butt lifts don't cause long-term damage. And they can be good for our reproductive numbers. I don't know, that's my favorite joke in the whole thing. Come on, Brazilian butt lifts, that's funny. Given that it's only in the first few months that the James Webb Telescope has begun searching for life on other planets and other star systems, why don't we just admit that we don't know our role in the universe? We are at the beginning of our exploration. We should be humble in the face of our collective ignorance and stop acting like a bunch of fools. That's my new credo, by the way. Let's just admit we're ignorant and stop acting like a bunch of fools. But seriously, if we met up with intelligent life forms from other star systems and could really figure out how to communicate and shoot this shit with them and compare histories, maybe here are some things we'd hear them say. You have the best moon, man. We'd kill for a moon like that. We would have evolved 120 million years earlier if we had a big moon like that. Maybe they'd say, Hate to tell you this, but your magnetosphere is subpar, and it's about to switch poles. Or maybe they'd say, you call those bagels? We've got millions of bagels. Or maybe they'd say, remember that asteroid that took out the dinosaurs? You're welcome. Or maybe after a few drinks, they'd say, back when we were still 60 light years out, we tuned into a couple Johnny Cash tunes, and we knew right away things had gone downhill. And then as we curved around Alpha Centauri and heard Eminem's music, we knew we were probably too late to help you. Or maybe they'd be frank with us. Look, we reproduce very differently than you. We just do it according to the math and science, and still very pleasurable. For you, my man, it's way more complicated. Way more complicated. I can't believe how complicated it is. And we'd be like, take us with you. Take us to your leader. Or maybe at the end of the night, as they're putting on their coats and getting ready to leave, they'd say one more very important thing. They'd say, planet Earth, more than any other place we've ever seen, anywhere in any of the galaxies, is a paradise built for pleasure. And you, Homo sapiens, except for your anger issues, you too, biologically, are built for pleasure. All the hard work is done. We have to go back to our planet and mine rocks and mix concrete. That's our purpose. But your purpose, dear humans, even though your bagels are not what they're cracked up to be, is to delight in the sweetness of existence. Now get the hell out of our way, or we'll use our Jewish lasers on you. But I think really what I'm trying to say is, we have a good universe, and good universes are hard to find. It has great fundamental principles that are very supportive of life. If the nuclear force was just a little stronger, atoms wouldn't have formed, and there wouldn't be any lithium or Adderall or THC. If the forces of gravity were just a little weaker, stars wouldn't hold together, and that would mean no photosynthesis, which would mean no plant life on Earth, which would mean a lot of growers in Pueblo would be unemployed. And if time moved just a little bit faster, you'd already be home watching the news. So count me among those who believe this is a pretty darn good universe. Little on the slow side, yes. Little bit on the empty side, yeah. Not much of a talker, true. But otherwise, a damn good looking universe. Sure, it's a little gassy, sometimes explosive, but it shines with more galaxies than we can count. It's got the right fundamentals. Now, I spent about 3 weeks preparing for this show. And in that time, the stock market lost 10% of its value. But also in that time, the universe expanded by roughly 336 trillion miles. Oh, it feels good to be heading back home. I don't know what it's expanding into. I don't think anyone really does. But things are on the move. Things are on the move these days. And before you leave tonight, I want to go off script for a minute. And I just want to tell you a very short story about a moment in human evolution when we learned how to really cooperate, especially the men. It was probably about 200,000 years ago when men were hunters and women were gatherers. What they figured out is big game with furry bodies don't sweat through their skin. They sweat through their mouths. But humans with no fur sweat through our biggest organ, our skin. And while we are not the fastest nor the strongest, our competitive advantage was we were unusually built to run a long way at a modest speed. So people figured out they could team up together with their spears and run the wildebeests and run the antelope and even run the woolly mammoths for miles and miles until the animal was so out of breath, it became an easy kill. And everyone had food on their Passover table. And they dipped twice. And they even had their first men's group. And our brains grew substantially in that period. Our ability to communicate grew. Our hearts, in the metaphoric sense, also grew. Because that was the beginning of what I like to call the love revolution, which is the hallmark of our species. It didn't begin in San Francisco in 1966. We've been working on this for 500,000 years. And the social experiment isn't over, friends. We know we somehow have a mission, either from the universe itself or somehow encoded in our very DNA, to be wise stewards of our lush planet, at least until further notice, at least until otherwise instructed. Not only because it's fun and groovy and you get to wear bell bottoms, but also because, for all we know, we have the best magnetic field in the universe that other planets would drool for. Or we have the best plate tectonics that other life forms would kill for. Or it's possible, it is quite possible, we have more biodiversity than any other planet in the universe. And if not that, maybe we still have a good shot at winning best beaches in the Milky Way.
You don't need to worry about him. He's gonna make it somehow. He's gonna make it some. Yes, he's gonna make it some. He's gonna make it somehow. And you don't need to worry about her. She's gonna make it somehow. She's gonna make it some. Yes, she's gonna make it some. She's gonna make it somehow. How? I really don't know how. That's something she's just gonna have to wait to find out. Lord knows it seems a little bit like wishing upon a star. But everything gonna work itself out. Yeah, 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 yeah. Everything gonna work itself out. We don't need to worry about them. They're gonna make it somehow. They're gonna make it some. Yes, they're gonna make it some. They're gonna make it somehow. They don't need to worry about us. We're gonna make it somehow. We're gonna make it some. Yes, we're gonna make it some. We're all gonna make it somehow. How? I really don't know how. That's something we're just gonna have to wait to find out. Lord knows it isn't easy with this clutter all around. But everything gonna work itself out. Yeah, 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 yeah. Everything gonna work itself out. I'm telling you,
and your papa thinks so too. I'm telling you, the chimpanzees will be freed from the zoo. Everyone you've ever loved is gonna be there too. With everything just naturally work itself out.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much. Could we turn the house lights up for a second? I appreciate you all coming out to the show tonight. I want to see you a little bit and get to know you. How many of you are here at Fiske Planetarium for the first time? Give me one of these, how about? Yeah, cool. Well, welcome. That's awesome.